which says I am. I can do what it says I can do. I believe what it says about me. And I obey what it says to me. This Bible is my roadmap for success. The instructions to fulfill my purpose are contained in this word. Thank you, Lord, for speaking to me through your word. I open up my heart, my mind, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We just thank God tonight for everyone coming out. Hallelujah. You want to just give God glory for being in this place tonight. We want to give God glory tonight. Hallelujah. For his awesome presence in this place tonight. Hallelujah. Want to honor my pastor and first lady tonight. And thank God for the opportunity to stand before God's people. Hallelujah, to share, hallelujah, the word of God tonight. We appreciate your pastor for honor, giving me this opportunity. Thank you, Lord God, hallelujah. And pray God's richest blessings upon you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, thank you, Lord. I gave you a little picture tonight. This had come to me. I guess about a month ago, and so tonight I had a hard time today trying to get the right thing and trying to get it on the paper, so I ended up having to cut and paste. Had to go back to old school. Hallelujah. But there is a reason. On that little picture, it's a picture of the human anatomy. And what I need you to do is look at that picture. Take your pencil, a pen, and I need you to put an X on every part of your body that the enemy has attacked or is attacking. Put an X on every part that the devil has attacked or is attacking. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm giving you a couple of just a minute or two to do that. And then we're going to go on. Hallelujah. Now, God has a plan for our lives and has had a plan. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. And his plan, he shall fulfill. And you know, his plans are... He said, I know the thoughts that I think toward you. And they're for your good, not for your evil. And he said he's even going to bring us to an expected end. In other words, with the things that you desire, that you are expecting, he said, I will bring you to the expected end. Amen. Hallelujah. So, as you look at that picture there, and I looked for one that had all the little names, you know, with the, with the different organs, and used to be on there, but I could only catch one side of it. So anyway, does anyone have over five X's on that picture? Over five X's on that picture. Okay. Does anyone have four? Okay. Three? Okay. Does anyone have more than one on there? Okay. For every X that you have on that sheet, that is an attempt of the enemy to steal your peace. That's an attempt of the enemy to steal what God gave to you. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, the word of God tells us, you know, that I said, steal your peace. And the peace of God in the Hebrew is nothing missing and nothing broken. nothing missing, and nothing broken. So God wants us to have peace. And he wants us to have his peace, not the world's peace, but his peace in our spirits, our souls, and our bodies. There is a very familiar greeting that we see in the Bible over and over and over in the Pauline epistles. And it's a greeting that was used in that day in secular letters. Like we say, when I write a letter, I would say, "Dear Dana." But this is what they would put in place of the "dear" whatever. So I want to just show you something. Go with me to Philippians. We're going to look at three of them. And there's a point for this. Philippians 1 and 2. And this is and it says, Paul and Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Jesus Christ, which are at Philippi with the bishops and deacons, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Now look at Colossians 1 with me. We're going to go Colossians 1 and 2. And it reads, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timotheus, our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ which are at Colossae, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So first they say who's writing, where the letter is coming from, Paul and Timothy. And then it expresses to the saints in that particular area a thought. Ephesians 1 and 2. I'll read that one to you. Listen, it says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus and to the faithful in Jesus Christ, grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. In each of those greetings, he spoke grace and what? Grace and peace to that church, or to the citizens in that area. And he spoke that each time. That was a greeting, but it is also an expression to the saints of that day that he was speaking to of what God has already done. Grace and peace. Grace and peace be unto you. It speaks of what God has already done through the redemptive work of Jesus Christ. It's already done. Amen. So tonight, my message is on grace for healing. Grace for healing. Now, I want to read this scripture to you. It's one of my favorites, becoming one of my favorites, since I've been meditating on this. And just listen. And it's in Romans 5:1-2, and it says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Living Word, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. We are standing in grace. It's the grace wherein we stand. Not we're going to be moved into grace. We are in his grace right now. I couldn't have placed myself in his grace. Who placed us in his grace? God did it through Jesus Christ. Amen. Say, I'm standing in the grace of God. Hallelujah. And I rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. That's God's desire. Amen. Hallelujah. So God had for us a very definite plan for each one of our lives. And his plan is very visible. I'm going to back up, give you some background. His plan is very visible when you look at the Garden of Eden before the fall. He made man and woman. He put them in a place to live. Did they have to build a house? Did they have to buy a house? Who gave them a house? Amen. Glory to God. He supplied everything that they needed. Every fruit, every tree in the garden, they were free to eat of except that one tree. So they didn't have to cook. They didn't have to work. Just go and pick you some fruit and eat. Amen. Glory to God. So he supplied their needs in the garden. Amen. Glory to God. Before, he even clothed them. Because he clothed them in his glory. They were clothed in the glory of God. They were clothed in the light, the glory of God. They were clothed like he was clothed in the glory. Because they were made in his image and after his likeness. So when Adam and Eve fell in the garden, because of the sin, we were separated. We were separated. But originally, God's plan was to bless us, to keep us, and to fellowship with us. In the cool of the evening, the word of God says he would come down in the evening and talk to his man. Amen. And you know, I think about Adam, how Adam was made in God's image, and how God passed the animals all by Adam and said, you name them. That means he had the mind of Christ already, right? Yeah. He was made in the image after his likeness, and so are we. Amen. Glory be to God. So just like God had chosen Adam, but Adam fell, God chose you and I also. Hallelujah. And in Ephesians, I'm just listening for a minute. In Ephesians 1 and 4, it tells us that he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. He chose us in Christ Jesus. He chose us in him. Hallelujah. In Ephesians 1 and 5, he tells us that he predestinated us. He already had a plan for us. We were preordained. And it says that he did that, hallelujah, so that we could be adopted by him again through Jesus Christ. So he always had us in mind. And then in Ephesians 1 and 4, it says, 1:11, it says, also we have obtained an inheritance. We have obtained an inheritance. In this grace that we're standing in, we have an inheritance. Hallelujah. So in all of creation, for us as new creations, Jesus is the center of the life of the new creation being. He is the center. All life flows from him. All light for us is on him. All light for us is from him. All light for us is through him, as is life. So God's plan is for us to be like Jesus. To be like Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. You know, when I'm not much of an outside person, but Leon is. He loves outside. So he went out and he planted some collard greens this year. And he planted collard seeds. So he got these nice collard greens. Okay? So the seed produced what was inside the seed. Amen? Yeah. So God wanted some Christ people. He wants people to be like Christ. So Christ Jesus was planted in the earth. Jesus was planted in the earth. Glory to God for you and I. And Jesus rose on the third day for you and I. Amen. And the word of God tells us, you know, that when he was raised up, he was raised up by the glory of the Father in a newness of life. But then it tells us a little bit further over in the book of Ephesians that we were raised up with him. He raised us up. Amen. And he seated us in heavenly places with him. My God, at the right hand of the Father. Hallelujah. So our thing is we have to learn how to operate from our seated position. We are seated, and we realize that that's spiritually, because physically I'm right here. But we are seated in heavenly places. And you know, the good thing about, I like to think I'm on this, and I have to use it sometimes when things are getting a little rough. I, being seated in heavenly places, I can look down and see what the devil is doing. I can see his plots and plans and schemes. And I open up my mouth and take authority. Amen. That's God's plan. Take dominion. Subdue the earth. You bring the earth into control. Wow. Hallelujah. So God's plan was to be like Christ, the seed that was planted, because Adam's sin cut us off from what God had planned for us. But according to Proverbs 19:21, the plan of God will always stand. It will always stand. Even when somebody messes up God's plan, look at how they, the devil thought he had really done something. But what did God do? Turn right around and put us right back to where he originally had us. Now, we got to learn how to get there and live there. Amen. Hallelujah. So God sent Jesus Christ to rescue us from the sin. And that word rescue is really the meaning of salvation. He sent him to rescue us or to save us from sin and to restore to us the blessings that we had lost in the garden and to restore to us the fellowship that he desired with us. They say we were made for his glory. Look at 2 Corinthians with me. It's on your sheet. And you all know this anyway. But 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature, that the old things are passed away, and behold, all things are new. And 18 says, and all things are of God. Hallelujah. So if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. So if I am in Christ, I'm a new creature, then that means I have Christ's life abiding in me. You have Christ's life abiding in you. Christ's life. Hallelujah. Because you put your faith in Jesus Christ, in his redemptive work, in dying on the cross for you, bearing your sins, your sickness, your diseases, there is a door that's open to you. And that door is the door called grace. It's the door called grace. You know, the Word of God says that when Christ was raised from the dead, what happened is he delivered us out of the powers of darkness, and he translated us into the kingdom of the Son of his love. He took us out of darkness and translated us into light. He took us out of sickness and disease and planted us into health and wholeness. He took us out of poverty and lack and placed us into wealth and riches. He took us out of being tormented in our minds and in our bodies, in our souls, and placed us into the kingdom where we can have peace. He took us out of every dark thing, all the fruits of darkness. We've been delivered from those and positioned in a place of light and love and peace. Hallelujah. But the confidence to have truly to buy there is we have to have our confidence in the Lord Jesus Christ. We got to realize that we are rooted in him. That's why we are grounded in him. Hallelujah. So when you step inside that door of grace, what you find is that everything that you will ever need has already been provided. It's already provided. Hallelujah. It's already done. It's already done. Say it's already done. It's already done for you. When you step into that place of grace, it should be a place of peace. Because you shouldn't have to really labor too hard in the place of grace. It's already done. And this verse came to me, it's been a while now, but it stays with me. It stays with me. And what it says that the only thing that he wants us to do is believe in the one that he sent. And the more I'm getting a revelation, the more I realize it's all in the one he sent. That's why he said, all I want you to do is just believe. That's John 6:29. Just believe on the one that I have sent. He got it all for you. He's done it all for you. Hallelujah. But I need you to realize that as new creatures in Christ, your spirit is new. Your spirit was born again. When you received him, your spirit was made brand new. You look at your body, it's still the same. It still wants to do the same stuff. Your mind still want to think the same thoughts and tell your body, let's go do this. Oh, we going to do this tonight. You remember so and so and so. Let's go see them. Knowing that somebody that they ain't supposed to be hanging around. Let's go do so and so and so. The things that they know are not what they're supposed to do. But the mind has not been renewed yet. The mind has not been saved yet. Your spirit is new. Your spirit is who you have become. You are a new creature. You are a spirit being made in the image of God. Hallelujah. By his life coming in you. So you are a spirit. How am I going to operate as a spirit? How am I going to get all these things here that God has provided for me? Realize that everything that you need is in your spirit. Then that newly created part, it's all in there. It's all in there. But you have also, you have a soul, which is your mind, your will, and your emotions. And you have a body that you have to deal with. So we have to work on the other parts of us. We got to work on the other parts. That's our work right there. That's where your labor comes in. Amen. Look at 2 Peter 1:3. And it says, according as his divine power hath given us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue. It's according to his divine power. There is a new power in you, a divine power that's abiding in you. And that divine power has given you all things that pertain, everything you need that to pertain to life and to living a godly life. You already have it, as well as all things, hallelujah, that you need for spiritual development. He's given you all of those things. But it's according, listen to what it says, it's through the knowledge of him. Through the what? The knowledge of him that has called you to glory and virtue. See, God has called us back to glory. Adam lived in the glory. He has called us back to glory. But the only way we're going to live in the glory is we've got to have the knowledge. We got to have the knowledge of what he says. What he said, how he said to live. How do I do this thing? Do I just do it? Well, you know, I saw it in the book that it said do it this way. Was God's book. Did they get directions from God when they wrote that book? Be careful what you allow to go into your spirit. Because only the knowledge of God is going to bring you to that place of glory. Only the knowledge of God. So all of these gifts he's given us that pertain to life and godliness, there are so many of them, but I'm going to focus this on two. And healing is one of those gifts that pertain to life and godliness. If you're going to live a good life, you need to be healthy. If you want to live a life that you can truly enjoy, you can really just enjoy life, you want to be pain-free. You want to be disease-free. You want to be whole. Amen. So this knowledge that we have is going to come right here from this book. That's our roadmap for success. Fits right in. Our roadmap for success. Amen. So the scriptures you have are very familiar scriptures. You know, and sometimes I with the healing school, I say, well, God, I need something new. And I try to look for something new. So today it came to me, are they walking in the ones that they have already? Are they living? Are they succeeding in just applying what's here? Are you walking pain-free? Are you walking in healing? Is the devil still bothering your body? And of course he's going to come, but when he comes, are you able to stand in your victory, to stand in the grace provided for you? Amen. 1 Peter 1:24 says, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sins should live unto what? Righteousness. By whose stripes ye were healed. Ye were healed by the stripes of Jesus. So this is the knowledge of him that will help you to walk in healing. 1 Thessalonians 5:23 says, and the very God of peace sanctify you. Sanctify means he sets you apart. Holy. And I pray God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved or be kept intact, blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So this scripture here is one that we need to pray every day about, say every day of our body. It needs to be something better than your spirit. Say it every day. If you're not sick, you're saying, sanctify me, keep me from it. You know? If you are sick, you will still want to speak it. If you're having problems, issues, speak it. Power in the word of God. And then Isaiah 53 But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. So we are healed. We know that already from 1 Peter 1:24. But here he says he bore the chastisement of our peace. He was chastised, or he was punished. He was beaten for your peace, for your nothing missing, for your nothing broken in your spirit, in your soul, in your body, in your finances, in your children, in everything that pertains to you. Amen. Glory be to God. So these are some things that pertain to life and godliness. Now here's another one. God wants us whole. He wants us happy. Hallelujah. He wants our jar to be full. So he wants us to have some money. He wants us to have money so that there's no lack in our lives. So that we can do what we need to do and have what we need to have. 2 Corinthians 8:9 says, "For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, or the provision of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich." And somebody say, rich, do you mean we're supposed to be rich? We're supposed to be rich? Well, I didn't write this. This is the word of God. This is the word of God. And rich does not mean you're going to be a millionaire. Amen. As a matter of fact, I really believe that when it comes to words, we are, the word rich for me, and my mindset, my limitations are right here. Whereas you might think, for you, rich may be, I just want to do this, 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 and that. Well, for you, that's being rich. But my mindset may take mine, may be higher or lower. Rich is a place where you are content that your needs are met and that you're happy where you are monetarily. Amen. So this is the word of God. So in John 10:10, what does the word of God say? Okay. John 10:10, he wants us to have what? Life and that more abundantly. Life and that more abundantly. You see, and the life and that more abundantly is what God has given us with grace when we really walk in the grace of God. We can have more abundant life, more abundant living. So this is what God wants. But we're going to have to get into the word of God to get the knowledge for everything that we have need of. And then we're going to see how to get it to moving and working in our lives. In Romans 4:16a, it says, "Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed." He's saying that, first of all, you've got to have faith in Jesus Christ. So it's first by faith. And once faith comes in Jesus Christ, remember, he opened the door, moved us out of darkness. Grace door is open where you can walk into that grace. It stands you, it positions you in this grace of which I stand. In the grace of which I stand, whatever I need, I have. So it's there by faith that it may be by grace. And the end would be that all of the seed, all the children will have the promises of God that's in this book. That's the end. Amen? Make sense? Amen. Okay. So these promises of healing, riches, peace, protection, joy, and whatever you need is received in the same manner in which you got saved. You believed in what Jesus Christ had done, and you put your faith in that redemptive work. And when you did that, grace was opened up to you. The grace was opened up. The goodness was opened up. The favor of God was opened up to you. That's all concluded in the grace. All fruit of his love for you. And so what happens, he has opened back up the plan for you that was shut down when Adam sinned. It's opened up to you again. So how am I going to get these things flowing in my life? How am I going to get these blessings, all these blessings that pertain to life and godliness flowing in my life? Well, you're going to have to do something with your soul. You're going to have to work on the soul. The soul can be kind of stubborn. You know how you've been doing something for a long, long time? You've been doing it for a long time. It's been your life. This is the way I've done it. And people will say, I did this. I've done this all my life. I've always done it this way. And I don't want to change. But if you're going to have the blessings of God, you're going to have to change. We have to do it God's way. See, because your soul, man, is the one who's holding you up. Because your spirit is already blessed. Your spirit is already healed. He's already prosperous. Amen. It's already provided in the spirit, in your spirit. Amen. So now we got to work on the soul. So in Acts 20:32, let me read this to you. It's on your paper. It says, and now, brethren, and now, living word, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. Amen. Remember he said, you have come to an inheritance. This word of grace that you are being commended to, or committed, or entrusted to, that word of grace is able to give you the strength that you need, or to edify, or to build you up, so that, and when you are built up, it will give you the blessings. It's going to come through the knowledge of the word of God. Amen. So we can't afford laziness where the word is concerned if we want to walk in the blessings. Amen. So new creation beings, this is what we're going to, how we're going to work on our soul, on the soul man. There's a scripture that talks about being renewed in the spirit of your mind. And I didn't even know that the mind had a spirit, but it says you be renewed in the spirit of your mind. So this is what we're going to have to do. We're going to have to renew our minds to the point to where we think like God thinks. Look at Romans 12:1-2. And it says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye build your bodies a living sacrifice, present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So he's telling you here, don't be conformed to the world. Don't act like the world. Don't talk like the world. You can't say what the world says and get the blessings of God. You got to say what God say. You can't do what the world do and expect the blessings. Well, you can expect, I mean, get the blessings of God. If you want to walk in the blessings, you've got to do it God's way. And the biggest thing, one of the hardest things, like I'm talking about with the soul, when the soul's been doing something for a long time, it's like it's automatic. You know, I don't have to think about how I'm going to put my key in the ignition. I don't.
No, I don't have to think about certain things. We just get up and we do them because we've been doing it and doing it and doing it and doing it. But if we're going to follow the word, some things we have been doing like the world even. You know? Yeah, we have. You know, the word of God says, "Oh man, oh no man, nothing but to what? Loving." How many people do you owe? Really? So we want to conform our thinking to the point to where our thinking so lines up with God until we know in our hearts that what he said is true. He's going to do just what he said he would do. I don't have a doubt about it. I don't have to deal with the world. So what we're going to have to do is get our thoughts in alignment with the thoughts of God. So I'm going to use healing as an example. You can, for any area of your life, you can do the same thing. Just find the word for what you're dealing with. So the enemy is coming against my body. What am I going to do? I'm going to, first of all, watch what comes out of my mouth. I'm going to watch my words. And I'm going to be mindful also of who I share my business with. You have to be careful about that. Everybody who sits on the bench in a church don't believe what you believe. You be careful what you share, because you tell one person, before you know it, your business all over Baton Rouge, Louisiana. And they're tearing you down. You're trying to build yourself up, and your words, and the words getting further and further out there. Oh, she got so-and-so, so she gonna die. So what you want to do is you want to look in the book of grace. When it says the knowledge of the book of grace, the word of God. You're going to look into the book of grace, and you're going to see what the book of grace says about what you're standing and believing for. What part of these blessings that God has provided for you in this grace you're working on obtaining right now, what you need right now. So you're going to take that word, put that word in your mouth, and that's what you're going to say concerning your situation, that and that only. No matter what happens, no matter how you feel, no matter how it looks, no matter what the doctor says, say what the word of God says. Amen. Glory to God. So you're going to take the word of God, and you're going to take that word, and you're going to look at that word. You're going to speak that word. You're going to pray in the Holy Ghost. Build yourself up in the Holy Ghost, on your faith in that word. Amen. Then you're going to meditate on that word. To meditate on that word, you're going to take that word and just going to say it. You may say it 30, 40 times a day. God, I praise you. I am healed by the stripes of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Every time a pain hits your body, God, I thank you. I'm healed by the stripes of Jesus. It's not a pain hitting your body. God, I give you praise. I'm healed by the stripes of Jesus. You meditate on healed by the stripes of Jesus. I'm healed. Healed. What does heal mean? What does heal mean? Heal means to be free from sickness and disease, free from pain. Heal means that my body is whole. There is no sickness in me. Amen. Glory to God. Healed by the stripes. What are stripes? Stripes. I had to look the word stripes up to see that they were talking about the licks that he bore every time they hit him. It was called a stripe. It was called a stripe. So I meditate on that. I meditate on that. That he has taken this for me. He took it for me. He did this for me. I am healed. I am healed by the stripes of Jesus. He bore it for me. He delivered me from sickness and disease. I am delivered. Thank you, Lord God. Praise you, Lord God. The meditating on the word of God It's what causes that word to become embedded in your soul, and it's already in your spirit. But when your soul and spirit begin to connect, you can feel it. You can feel it. Amen. Hallelujah. It takes root. It takes root. And what you're doing now, you're not being conformed to what the world thinks. You're being transformed. You know how that ugly caterpillar becomes this beautiful butterfly and just fly away? That's what's happening to your soul. Hallelujah. And then you're going to speak the word of God. I mean, it's getting in you. You're getting it in you. And you're going to speak it out of your mouth. And your spirit and your mouth and your spirit and your soul are connecting. And you're going to begin to release that into your body. See what, and I'm going to get ahead of myself. You're going to release into your body. Every scripture that you've deposited in your soul, that you have depositing, begin to release it into your body. And then you want to give God some thanks. Father, I thank you. Father, I praise you for healing. I thank you, Jesus. I thank you for every stripe you bore for me, Jesus. I thank you for loving me enough to die for me. You didn't have to do it, Jesus. You didn't have to die for me. You did because you loved me. Thank you for loving me so much. Thank you, God, for loving me enough to send your son to carry that for me. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. So as you begin to release that word into your body, release it into your body. See, so now you're working the knowledge of the book of grace so that this grace you're standing in can manifest for you because it's already yours. Father, I thank you. See, when you say, Father, I thank you for healing my body, you're agreeing that grace has already done it. I've got it, God. I've got it, God. You thank him for it. Amen. It's very important that when you speak, as you're releasing, that you are releasing your words in faith. In faith. So that your healing is by his grace. You got to be released in faith. The just shall live by faith. Give God much thanks. Much thanks and much praise. Holly, thank him for his grace. And so if you're dealing with financial lack, do the same thing with your money. Don't just drop your money in the bucket and say, I fulfilled my commitment. I gave them $10 today. When you sow a seed, my God, you put some word on that seed. You water that seed. You fertilize that seed with the word of God. Father, I thank you for the seed that you've given me to sow. And God, I praise you that my seed is being planted in good soil. It's going to bring forth fruit. 30, 60, 100 fold. God, I want 100 fold. That's going to prosper. I thank you, Jesus, that you became poor that I might become rich. Praise God, I'm becoming rich. I'm rich. Hallelujah. Begin to decree. Don't people think you're crazy? It's okay. They're acting crazy. You still acting crazy every day, and you just let them go and be crazy. It's okay, let them think you're crazy. But when they just hide and watch, see if your blessings don't come. See if the fruit of God, if the fruit of the grace doesn't begin to show up in your life. So do that for your riches, for your protection, for your children, for deliverance, for whatever you need. See, because what happened is that healing was already there, but it was in your spirit. It's spiritual. It's a spiritual thing. Everything in this Bible, pretty much, is written for the spirit. It's for the spirit. And we're trying to walk in the natural. And that's been our problem. My God. So, what I had been doing was a pain hit my head, a pain. I would begin. I know the word. I just begin to speak the word. I begin to speak the word. I know the word. I expect the word to work. But this was a missing factor. I know the word. I'm healed in my spirit. But my mind was not renewed at a time. My mind had not been renewed. So I bypassed the soul and jumped from mouth, and I went right to flesh. So here I am. So spirit is in agreement that I'm healed. But soul gets the pain, and soul says, ooh, I hurt. So they're not walking together. You got to get these three things lined up. You got to get the three lined up, agreeing with each other for the manifestation. Amen. You got to be lined up. You got to be working together. Your spirit, your soul, and your body. So if your mind is already renewed in that particular area, then that's great. But if it's not, you've got to get the word of God rooted in your soul. You got to change your way of thinking. You got to take the word and put it in. Put it in. Put it in. Put it in until when you have a thought, any thought on an area, it's the thought of God. And you could tell when you get there. When things start being a bother to you, that thing start being a problem to you, you know it's there. Amen. So, but meditating, be sure you meditate on that word. Because meditating on the word has a tendency to keep that word alive in you. It keeps it alive. You know, so sometimes, you know, you can, I'll sing a scripture. I don't have no per se tune. I just sing out of my, just sing it. You know, if that's what I need. I just want to keep it alive. I need it working in me. I need it working in me. So you can say it. You can sing it. You can do anything you want to do. This thing is just to get it in your mouth and out of your mouth. Amen. So that grace for your soul says that, grace for your healing says that I'm already healed. You're standing in this marvelous grace. Hallelujah. And I decided that I will not frustrate the grace of God. I'm not going to act like he hadn't done anything for me in that area. I'm not going to act like that grace was not sufficient, that it wasn't enough to do what God said it was going to do. That grace is not accountable. It is accountable. It's enough. It's enough. His grace is sufficient. His grace is sufficient for whatever we need. We just have to kind of, you know, change our lifestyle some, our mindset some, and allow the grace of God to flow in our lives. Amen. Glory to God. Now I just want to encourage you to do one more thing. I'm going to do it over you tonight. I have put the scripture on there. It's Ephesians 1, and I put 16 through 23 here. And when I began to confess this scripture and to meditate this scripture over myself, and I began to confess it and speak it over living word and over other people, but when I began to do it over myself, I noticed that I could open up my Bible and I could read something and it made sense. I really understood much, much better what I was reading. Not to say I don't have a ways to go, but I thank God for the increase he's brought already. Amen. Praise you, Father. So I'm going to read it. I'm going to speak this over you right now. I want you to receive it. Father God, tonight, I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto every member of Living Word Church, all who are assembled here tonight, God, the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, that the eyes, Lord God, of their understanding being enlightened, that they may know what is the hope, Lord God, of your calling, and what is the riches of the glory of your inheritance in them, the saints. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe? According to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ, when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church. Made him to be the head over all things, Lord God, to living word. Made him to be the head over all things to me, for I am the body of Christ. Made him to be the head over all things that concerns me, God. The church, which is his body. We are his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. In Jesus' name. Praise you, God. Thank you. Say it, pray that Paul says, and that we may know the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe. Hallelujah. And that, listen, that's the same power. He wants us to know it. I don't mean just know it in your head, but to experience it, to live it. Hallelujah. That same power. Hallelujah. That was wrought when he raised Christ from the dead. That's resurrection power. He wants you to know, to live in that resurrection power. My God. That's freedom. My God. That's deliverance. That's everything. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Thank you, Father. Father God, we just give you praise tonight for the word. Father God, have your way in our lives, Lord God. Lord God, we just thank you, Lord God, that the Spirit of the Lord is quickening us tonight in this place.